Mancini IQ and bankrolls of sports bettors everywhere. The Better IQ Podcast is your source for sports betting information, analysis, and opinions. Learn, bet, win. Better IQ.
Hey, good afternoon, and welcome to the Better IQ Podcast. I'm your host, Andrew Lang. Happy to be here as we're going to kick off some more podcasts here moving forward as the Major League Baseball season obviously underway. We got the NBA set to get underway with their kind of abbreviated end of the regular season, and they push toward the playoffs. And we're hoping, we're optimistic that some form of football is going to take place here in the coming weeks and months. But for the time being, we're going to talk games here for today, as most of these teams, what, four or five games into their season. We've already had a ton of stuff going on, overs, unders, COVID, you name it, and it's only going to continue here as they race to the finish here this 60-game season. So as mentioned, we got a couple of afternoon games that we're going to break down some here for this evening, and we'll do so with our guest here this afternoon, Eric Waz. So let's welcome in. Waz, how are you?
I'm doing good. It's been an interesting baseball season already with the COVID, like you mentioned. We already got a team, the Marlins, here kind of sitting on the sidelines waiting to get better and don't know how it's going to play out with their season and how these games are going to get made up. But we knew this was going to happen, right? We knew we were not going to go through the whole season without some incidents. I think they've done a good job of saying, hey, let's take some time here and reevaluate things. They probably shouldn't have played that game on Sunday, I believe it was, knowing that some guys had it, but hopefully they learn from that. Everything gets a little bit stricter and tighter, so it doesn't happen again to this level. So yeah, I'm excited. We still got games going on, and it seems like a pretty good card today.
Yeah, I tweeted the other day, kind of half serious, half not, Waz. You're asking 26, 27, 28-year-olds that are multimillionaires to essentially sit still for 20 hours a day. You know, they go to the ballpark. These guys are working, but once they're done, it's difficult when you're having to kind of police. These guys are adults, and you know, they're used to having a little bit of a freedom. They need that freedom. They need to be able to decompress after spending hours at the game, and unfortunately they're just unable to do that right now if they want to continue to remain healthy. So it's going to be a tricky sledding here really for all the sports, because there's just so many players, so many coaches, so many staff. But let's talk some games here. We got an afternoon start, Colorado in Oakland. Montez for Oakland, big arm here, Waz, up and coming. I mean, he's geared up where he's got number one potential here moving forward for the A's. Marquez throwing for the Rockies. Oakland, kind of a medium-sized favorite here. We'll call it $1.50. Total's been bouncing back and forth a little bit. The screen I'm looking at has got 7.5 with juice toward the over. What are your thoughts here on this matchup?
Well, I really like both of these pitchers, first of all, especially Montas. I mean, he only really had two pitches last year, throwing a lot of fastballs and sliders. Now he kind of added a splitter, which is interesting, a different look. It's hard to be successful as a pitcher with just two pitches you can count on. So he had the third pitch. Looked really good in the exhibition start he had. Looked really good in his first start of the season. Bob Melvin's saying, hey, he's electric. I think he's one of the best pitchers in baseball right now. He's only going to get better. The bullpen for Oakland has been unreal so far. Going into yesterday's game, I'm not sure what they did yesterday. I think they gave up a few runs out of the bullpen. But the bullpen ERA is 0.44 ERA the first three games of the season. So the bullpen's firing all cylinders. You kind of seen that around MLB right now, where starters are a little bit struggling. You know, only going 3, 4, or 5 innings for the most part. But the bullpen's really been picking it up. And I think having those fresh arms, they have an extra 4 or 5 arms in the bullpen now. It's better for matchups. It's better for, being rested and fresh when you get into a game and not to pitch 3 days in a row. So I kind of like the under here. I mean, I like the Oakland pitching staff a lot, bullpen. I like Montas. Marquez had kind of a down season by his standards last year. But his velocity was up a little bit in his first start from where it usually is. And he had a lot of swinging strikes, and the hard hit percentage was pretty low. So I'm looking at the under. It was at 8, got bet down to 7.5 here, but I'm still looking at the under in this game.
Well, I was really quick. I'm going to ask you a fundamental question specifically about this total. when you're seeing, look, we know seven's a key number, nine's a key number, but when you're seeing that 7.5 to the over or the eight, mathematically, fundamentally, you know, for guys out there listening, you know, what's the right course of action in approaching that?
Yeah, I'd have to look it up exactly, but I think it's about 12 cents to go from 7.5 to 8. You know, it does vary depending on, you know, different factors, but for the most part, 7.5 to 8, yeah, it's about, actually it's a little closer to 10 cents. I'm looking at a chart I have over here. So it's about 10 cents. So really, you know, at the end of the day, if you can get the 7.5 with no juice versus getting, you know, 8.5 at -110, they're roughly the same. So I like, I'm just more conservative. I like getting the extra half run, and I'll pay the extra 10 cents or 12 cents to get it in most cases. Even though it might be a little bit suboptimal in some cases, just to have that extra security and just help with variance and things like that. So, but for the most part, every number just in baseball, you got to know every number, you know, whether it's 7, 8, 9, 10, they all have different values. There's some good resources out there you can use. Like SBR has a half run calculator where you can plug in the numbers and kind of get an idea of what each number is worth for a total. And you know, in sports like NBA, NFL, you can figure out what a point's worth, what a half point's worth. So I usually use that a little bit. Just look it up, SBR half point calculator, and it'll give you everything you need on there.
About Arizona and Texas and what is it, Globe Life Park continues to play heavily toward the under. Joey Gallo, I read a really interesting article. He talked about how, you know, some of the balls off the bat look really good, but end up kind of dying on the vine out there. You know, the roof has been closed. I'm wondering, you know, Waz, at what point does Texas say, look, we know it's hot down here, but let's open this roof and score some runs? Because, you know, for both teams, particularly Texas, offenses have been extremely limited. And to me, boy, this is the opponent. This is the opposing starting pitcher that maybe you do want to have that that roof open. And I haven't – I tried to check last night. I don't know if they're – like Arizona, Waz, always had an official site where you can go on every day. And they were really good about having, you know, multiple days in advance where you could see, all right, an upcoming series, they got, you know, Tuesday, Wednesday, roof's closed, you know, Thursday's open. I've not seen that here yet. For Texas, but Lance Lynn here on the hill for the Rangers. He's a short favorite going up against Bumgarner. You talked about these pitchers, particularly some of these veterans getting hurt or just not being in full game shape here yet. And Bumgarner, it appeared that, you know, he was going well in his first start, but kind of imploded. The one thing I noticed, though, his velocity, you know, look, this guy's chewed up a lot of innings, a lot of throws over his career. But that velocity was really down there in his first start. So perhaps Texas can find a way to plate some runs. Total, we've seen, look, markets are so quick to pile on this stuff, and it seems like the last two or three days, whatever number they post, Waz, they're betting it under. Shop I'm looking at right now has got 8 under 120. What are your thoughts here in the game?
Yeah, you mentioned the park, and that's kind of the story here. A lot of players, not just Gallo, I mean, a couple of opponents actually have said they're surprised at some of the balls they hit not getting out of the park there. So it's definitely a real effect. We've had 4 straight unders in a row in that park to open the season. None of them were really in jeopardy at any point of going over. So I think the linesmakers still have this a little bit too high. In addition, Arizona's not hitting the ball well at all right now. I think their hard hit percentage is something like 27th in the MLB. Their exit velocity is really low as well. So they're just not squaring things up right now. Both these pitchers, I'm kind of lukewarm on. I mean, you know, I think Lance Lynn had a kind of a, I don't want to say a career year last year, but it was pretty damn good. It was up there. And Bumgarner, you know, he's getting older now. He's not going to be able to go as deep into games. He's probably a little bit overrated at this point. So not crazy about these pitchers, but I still think that total, I think you're going to start to see numbers there that are some of the lower numbers in the AL. I mean, you're still seeing 8.5s get open there. We saw some 9s in the first couple of games, 9.5, I think, in one game. I don't think you're going to see for very much longer games opening 8.5, 9 there. I think you're going to see some 7.5s and 8s, which is very unusual in the American League. It might end up being one of the better pitcher's parks in the American League, which is kind of crazy to say, knowing how much of a hitter's park the last park was. So keep an eye on that. But that factor alone, I think, you know, I think I bet that 3 of the 4 games, I bet the under so far. I'm going to continue putting the money out there until it proves to go otherwise. But, you know, it's just one of those things. I think every year we see you know, two or three parks make a tweak, whether it's a new park, whether it's pushing the fences in, pushing the fences back, you know, whatever it is, it ends up always, you know, being a factor that the market doesn't latch onto right away. The other one here is Marlins Park, which obviously they're not playing right now because of the COVID issues, but they moved their fences in, I think about 10 feet, a little different depending on where you're at in the field. And they were saying that the ball, more balls were getting out there, and that would be maybe turn to more of a hitter's park. So those are the two big ones for this season. And so far, so good on the Texas front.
White Sox in Cleveland, and White Sox 1-4. And, you know, you got to take kind of, you know, struggles. You got to take them seriously as a team, because we know the season is not all that short. We go back to the preseason, the White Sox. We talked about the White Sox and the Reds being kind of those up-and-coming teams that the preseason of betting markets latched onto. I don't think it's time to panic. But something to keep an eye on. They send Giolito to the hill. Tough start, you know, facing that Twins lineup first game. And I read, and Giolito got kind of lit up. Was quotes from him, quotes from the coaching staff. The velocity was there. I don't think it's anything to panic about. Again, that's arguably one of the toughest lineups in all of baseball to face. They're obviously really familiar with him, but you can make the argument that Cleveland is familiar with him as well. So I was kind of hoping that Giolito, we could get him at an underdog price. Not going to be the case here. He's a short favorite going up against a Plesac at a total of 9.5. A little bit of juice toward the under. What are your thoughts here, Waz?
Yeah, so Giolito is really interesting. If you look at his splits, you know, facing bad teams and good offenses and bad offenses, he's been really, really dominant against teams like the Tigers, the Royals, the Orioles. When he faces a team with an above-average offense like the Twins, like the Indians are kind of, I want to say they're somewhere in the middle because they're a little bit mediocre of offense. It's not great, but it's not bad. He's really struggled against, you know, competent offenses throughout his career, his short career. Last year, it was very, very extreme. I want to say his ERA against, like, above-average offenses was something like 6. And against teams that were, you know, the Royals and, you know, Tigers kind of teams, it was down like 2.5 ERA. So, you know, maybe he's, you know, just the way he pitches, he's able to dominate weak hitters somehow. And maybe it's just variance over, you know, the last couple of seasons. But I'm definitely not going to be backing him, you know, against a lineup that can definitely hit, especially Cleveland's lineup at home. They're a much better home hitting lineup than they are on the road for various reasons. I read a lot about Plesac, and I don't see too much there that I've liked so far. You know, he had a 381 ERA. If you look at the xERA, which is a new metric that Baseball Savant came out with that kind of tells you what, you know, ERA should be, it's sort of like FIT, but it's a little more advanced. 534 versus 381. So that's a run, over a run and a half of regression that probably should have happened last year. So he comes into the season probably a little bit overvalued. He has the name value. Obviously, his dad pitched in the major leagues. He was a highly touted prospect for a while. So I think people are probably looking to play him. And I'll have to wait and see on him before I put any money on his starts. But if I'm going to lean anywhere in this game, it's probably a little bit towards the over here. The White Sox seem like an over team. I mean, they great lineup. You know, a lot of young hitters kind of coming in their own. The pitching staff still really concerns me for the Sox. I mean, the bullpen, a lot of question marks. A lot of guys overperformed last year. And not crazy about any of the starters. I mean, Giolito's their best starter. He's the one guy that you hope you can count on, but you really can't yet. And they've been really, you know, Cease yesterday was not good at all. Rodon was not very good. So I think the Sox are going to struggle. I mean, everybody's got them this kind of up-and-coming team. I probably had them rated lower than anybody coming into the season. I still think it's going to be one more year until they kind of get to the point where they can contend. And so far, they've struggled.
Washington, Toronto, and we talked, you know, this is a year where, look, you still got to pay attention, obviously, to starting pitchers, but this is a year that perhaps you can get a little bit more creative and kind of lock on the, you know, teams, almost like a stock, like a buy low, sell high type of approach. And there were some teams heading into the season, in my opinion, that just kind of had the feel where, you know, maybe take a knee, just, you know, the effort and in certain circumstances, just not setting up well for them to really make a push. And Washington was one of those teams. Look, they expended a ton, particularly the pitchers, expended a ton of energy. Remember, they got off to that slow start. They were nothing almost at the All-Star break, and they made that monster push, got to the postseason, went deep in the postseason, a couple 7-game series, and they end up winning the World Series. now we get to this year. You could talk a little bit about the World Series hangover. You got the issue with Soto, a couple players opting out. So this is a team that, you know, there's some red flags here thus far, and I know it's early, but a team definitely to keep an eye on. And what we do know is, you know, Washington, particularly like Scherzer, Strasburg, these guys still carry and will continue to carry a ton of respect in the betting markets. But don't forget to factor in some of the other aspects here. Is Scherzer, he had a wild first start. Wise, you know how many pitches? I don't have the pitch count in front of me, but he had 11 strikeouts and 4 walks. That's incredible there against the Yankees, and he got hit around a little bit. He faces a Blue Jays lineup that we know. They're looking to hit the long ball. Pearson, he makes his debut. Don't know much about him. He's a big, hulking, right-handed kid, 6'5", 250, a JUCO kid. Not sure where he got drafted. And again, Nationals carrying a big price tag here, of course, because it's Scherzer, about $1.80. Total of 8.5. What are your thoughts, Waz?
Well, when I first saw this line yesterday, I almost kind of fell out of my chair that this can't be right. It's way too high, because I was looking at Toronto saying, okay, Toronto's at home. This Pearson kid is a highly touted prospect. He's one of the best pitching prospects in baseball. He throws 100 miles an hour. He's got great secondary pitches. He's going to be really good. And I couldn't believe the line was this high. Then I looked at it and realized, oh, Toronto's not at home. They're not the home team in this game at all, because they don't have a home yet. So, you know, you look at it and say, well, okay, you take that out of the equation. Okay, maybe this line makes a little bit more sense. I think they're – and I have to double-check this now. I think they're playing this game in Washington. So actually, you know, Toronto's the home team in Washington, technically. So that makes a little more sense. But I think this Pearson kid, I mean, he looks like to me, I've watched a few clips. I've read a lot about him. He's a guy you want to be betting on, not betting against. And people haven't seen him yet, obviously. So the first time through, you kind of think he has an advantage. I'm kind of with you in Washington. I'm kind of down on Washington. You're right. They have a few guys that sit out. I think Zimmerman sat out for the season. Wellington Castillo, one of their catchers. Soto has been out. Now, Soto's coming back today. He should be playing. He should be in the lineup today. He missed the first 4 games or 5 games with COVID, but he's tested negative a couple times in a row. So he should be in the lineup. I don't know if he'll be 100% as far as, you know, it might take him a game or two to kind of get back in the game flow. But also on Toronto's side, Bo Bichette, the shortstop, is questionable with a hamstring. Grichuk is questionable. So a lot of the key offensive players for these teams are questionable or out. And Washington's not hit the ball well so far. They've been struggling at the plate. I like Toronto's offense a lot. I think it's going to be kind of boom or bust for them a lot of games. They're going to strike out, hit a lot of home runs. So far, it's been a lot of home runs. But I think in this game, I like Pearson. I mean, Scherzer looks like, you know, he's in good form already. So I like the under here. It's 8.5 at most places, juiced a little bit toward the under in most places. I actually juiced both ways, depending on where you look. I was hoping I would have got a 9 on this game, but 8.5 is probably still good.
Cubs in Cincinnati, both Hendricks and Sonny Gray making their second start. Sonny Gray looked pretty good. Kyle Hendricks looked absolutely excellent. I've lost more money on this guy betting against him, Waz, than I think any current starting pitcher in baseball. I don't know how he does it, but he does it. And I watched that game against Milwaukee. In Milwaukee, guys were – you know what, guys are missing the ball by like, you know, 6-7 inches. It was one of the more – incredible performances that I've seen in recent memory. So as I lie here awake at night, I'm like, man, he cannot pitch any better than he did the other day. There's just no possible way. He's a great pitcher. I you know, my gut's telling me step in. There's going to be a little bit of a regression. And you know, and the good thing here is the price, I think, is pretty good on Cincinnati, man. They're just short favorites. It's almost a pick 'em. And you got a pretty capable starter here on the other end. It's not like you're going up against the number 5. You got Sonny Gray, who since coming over to the National League has proven that he's still got plenty left in the tank. Total of 9, slight juice the over. What's your take here, Waz?
Well, do you want to hear a crazy stat about Kyle Hendricks? I mean, this is kind of unbelievable. So career ERA, he's been in the league like 7 years now. And for all guys who have at least 950 innings pitched in their career, you know, decent sample size, he is 4th in all of baseball. The only guys ahead of him in career ERA are Kershaw, DeGrom, and Sale. And guys behind him are Bumgarner, Kluber, Strasburg, Scherzer, Gerrit Cole, David Price, Justin Verlander. I mean, all these are Hall of Famers, pretty much what we're reading off here. They're going to be Hall of Famers. And Hendricks is 4th on the list, career ERA. I mean, it's amazing. His peripherals aren't very good. They're very mediocre. Doesn't throw more than about 87, 88. But I watched that first game, and he had that curveball really going. He's really not – he doesn't really throw the curve very much, at least in the past. He's working out a lot during the break here with Contreras and, you know, figuring out ways to tinker with it a little bit. And his curveball was amazing. So, you know, a lot of times guys go complete game shutout. They dominate. Usually it's a good fade the next start. I still think that's the case in most instances where you want to do that because the market's probably weighing that a little too heavily. I don't know if I would do it here. I mean, I don't know. We'll see. I mean, Hendricks is one of those unique guys who kind of outperforms the peripherals and just always finds a way to get the job done. And you see it over his whole career. I mean, it's a big enough sample now that you got to kind of buy into it a little bit. The Cubs have been smashing the ball too. I mean, they're second in MLB hard hit rate. They're eighth in WOBA. I mean, exit velocity, they're second. They're seeing the ball well. They're hitting the ball well. Cincinnati, which is a team I was really, really high on going into the season. I'm still high on them. Last year, they just found ways to lose games. I mean, they should have been a 500 team last year. They finished like 18 games below 500 because they lost so many games that they should have won. I mean, you know, give up four runs in the ninth or losing a game in extra innings, they should have won because of a defensive error. I mean, you name it, they made the mistakes. And this year already, we're only, what, five games in. They had two games against the Tigers that they had in hand. They should have won. They gave away. So I don't know. I don't know if it's just more of the same for the Reds. They just can't figure out how to win games. So I'm a little leery now than more leery than I was going in. I'll probably stay away from this game, but I'll be very interested to see if Kendricks can, you know, back up that performance once again, and see if the Reds can just find a way to win games. Now they got the right personnel. They made some great moves in the offseason, great pitching staff, pretty good bullpen, one of the better lineups in the NL. They got all the right pieces, but you still got to put them together and they haven't figured out how to do that yet.
Shenanigans taking place last night in the Dodgers, a Houston game. You got Waz. Joe Kelly's a total clown. we knew this was going to happen. I think at some point, and you know, there's some bad blood, and you got to consider that it's, you know, potentially going to linger over. I read a couple tweets where, you know, Betts or Bellinger, in theory, you know, deserve to get one on their back. And look, I'm not going to play, you know, baseball police. You know, some of that stuff is just, you know, I'm too busy to be worried about things of that nature. But, you know, again, interesting the developments there for today. May goes for the Dodgers. It's crazy that the Dodgers, I mean, you know, obviously they have a lot of money, but they're through the draft developing players. This guy was a third rounder, Waz. How is he a third rounder? I mean, being a third rounder, you're obviously pretty good. He came out of high school, but he was down there in Texas. The competition's really good. And, I mean, this guy – he's legit. I mean, to me, he's got, you know, number one, at worst, number two stuff here down the road. He's only 22 years old. Javier for the Astros, obviously, they're a little thin on pitching. They've talked, and I think they've tried to make a couple of moves with Verlander out. What's the book here on Javier? You got the Dodgers here, about $1.30 road favorite, total of 10.
Yeah, I'm with you on May. I mean, Dustin May, he was great in that first start. And remember, he had to come in, you know, in kind of an emergency role. Because Kershaw wasn't ready and do that opening game start, and he was great. You know, he's got that power cutter that he throws like 94 miles an hour, that wipeout breaking ball that, you know, it's like 86, 87. You know, he's got all these pitches, and he's effective at throwing all of them. He's just got to master the mental side of the game because he's young, but he's doing a pretty good job of doing that already. So, yeah, he's going to be a top-of-the-rotation guy for years to come. The Dodgers are just loaded with talent. They find these guys. They draft well. They trade well. They're really good at developing players. Probably one of the best teams in the league at doing that. Dustin May is definitely a guy I want to be betting on, not be betting against. I can't imagine if you bet him every start for the next 3 years, you're going to lose any money. You're probably going to make some money there. So definitely looking in that direction. Well, let's face it, the Dodgers are more fired up for this game than the Astros are. I mean, the Dodgers are trying to get that revenge. Now, they kind of had, you know, the incident already happened where Kelly threw – at a guy, which I don't have a problem throwing at a guy, but you can't throw at his head. Come on. I mean, you can't, you know, hit the guy in the head. He can take him out for a long period of time, or who knows, even kill the guy. It'll probably happen eventually. So, you know, you can't do that. You can't head on the guy. But they made their statement. We'll see how this game plays out. You're right. Probably Dodgers get one back here. You know, maybe Betts gets hit with a pitch or something early on. We'll see. But I still think there's a lot of fire. You know, the Dodgers are still, you know, feeling like they still need to kind of get even. And they're probably more motivated for this game. I don't really use motivation a lot in baseball. It's sort of not there when they're playing every single day and there's no days off. Teams don't think about their opponents all that often. But in this case, I mean, the Dodgers had this series circled probably way back when. And, you know, I seem to be more ready to play this game. They got the better pitcher. Javier, I didn't really find a lot of good info on him either way. I mean, I don't think he's anything special. But the Astros have a way of turning guys that don't look special into something that's really good. So we'll see. I haven't made a bet in this game yet, but I do lean the Dodgers. I'm hoping to get a little bit better number. It's sitting at about 130, 135 right now. But I see it dip down to the 120s. I'll definitely be on LA here.
Yeah, you can't throw on a guy's heads. I mean, that's
you can't do that.
I threw at one guy on purpose, and I learned my lesson. A guy grunted after he hit a home run off me, Waz. And this was back in the day when metal bats were, like, totally juiced. So a guy hits a home run off me. I was just a happy-go-lucky guy, but all my teammates are like, you can't let him do that. So the kid, later in the game, he leads off an inning. So I put one on his back like I'm supposed to. All my teammates are like, yeah, you know, get him back. I think I end up giving up like 6 runs that inning. So that was the last time. I'm like, my ERA is way more important than, you know, these baseball etiquette rules. But you're right. It's a dangerous deal. Last game here was Royals and Tigers. Two kind of soft-tossing lefties here on the hill. Boyd here for the Tigers. He got hit a little bit against Cincinnati. Duffy, he's another guy, and this has been kind of a common theme with some of these veteran guys, guys that have arm difficulties. Duffy obviously qualifies as both. His velocity was significantly down there in his first start. Unfortunately, if you want to kind of play against that, you got to do so. And look, the Tigers are 3-2. That's fine. You know, laying a price for the Tigers, particularly laying a price with Matt Boyd, who just doesn't do a whole lot for me. You got to be a little bit careful. Look, we know both teams not very good. You got a high total of 10. That's kind of speaking even more so to, you know, this game to me is just kind of random where there's going to be plenty of hits, plenty of runs. And to me, a game that sets up, I think, Waz, where, all right, starting pitchers, let's call it even. I think the best route is really to dissect and, you know, what bullpen is better, what bullpen is in better shape here to be able to handle those late innings with, again, runs expected. So as it is, Tigers about $1.30, and as mentioned, total of 10. What do you got?
Yeah, you pretty much nailed it. I mean, this was a great overplay, I think. I mean, Duffy, you're right. His fastball was down 1.4 miles per hour in the last start than as usual. His slider was down by 1.8 miles per hour. So he's definitely not, you know, back into good shape ever. He's throwing hard. Those are huge. People who don't look at velocities very often might say, oh, it's only 1.4 miles per hour. Can't be that big of a deal. That actually equates to like something like a run or run and a half more in ERA if you fall that much over your baseline. So it's a huge deal. And Boyd, I don't like Boyd that much. I mean, he was one of those guys who was great in the first half last year. And then the league kind of figured him out a little bit. He didn't really adjust or adapt very well, and he got smashed in the second half. It was ugly. If you look at his splits last year between first half and second half, one of the biggest splits you'll see of last season. And he's, you know, I don't think he's really rebounded all that well. He was bad against the Royals last year too. I mean, and I'm a big guy with matchups as far as teams, but he got pounded by the Royals last year. And Kansas City's hitting the ball really well right now. They're third in exit velocity. They're up there in hard hit rate. They've got a decent lineup. They're kind of sneaky good lineup. The top 4 or 5 hitters in their lineup, you got Merrifield, you got Mondesi, Soler, you got Salvador Perez, who can still hit once in a while. You know, you got a good top half of the lineup. You know, it gets ugly at the bottom. You know, when you go 7, 8, 9, it's ugly like a lot of teams. But they can hit the ball. And I think the Tigers and the Royals, as you know, before yesterday's games, I think they were number 1 and number 3 in the league in home runs. Which you wouldn't expect from these teams, but they've been seeing the ball really well and hitting it well. So, again, with these starters, both of which I don't like, the bullpens are definitely subpar. You got two teams hitting the ball well. I think everything here points to an over.
Yeah, you got to be careful. You brought up a good point there with the velocity, and you're right. Statistics bear it out. I mean, the harder you throw, the lower the batting average is, you know, batting average against. But I think you got to kind of look at each guy individually. If I see a number 4 or a number 5 starter and he's right-handed wise and he typically throws 93 or 94, but now all of a sudden he's throwing 91 or 92, that's a big red flag. We know that. But I've seen guys, you know, Kershaw is a good example. Guys get older. You know, they lose a couple. Look, you know, you get past 30 and that velocity is going to decline. That's just the nature of, you know, humans and pitching, et cetera. But some guys we've seen, have dropped, you know, 2, maybe even 3 miles per hour over the course of 4 or 5 years, but they, you know, they're smart. They have multiple pitches and they're able to kind of get away with it. So, and the reason I bring that up is I'm a big velocity guy and I've got burnt just kind of, you know, looking at that velocity. Oh, this guy's down a tick or two and kind of playing off those numbers, those major league average numbers where, you know, this guy's ERA is going to be higher. And sometimes it pans out, sometimes it doesn't, but I recommend more, you know, kind of, you know, handicapping each individual guy. You got a soft tossing lefty, who's, you know, a big curveball cutter type guy. Well, him losing a mile per hour or a mile per hour and a half on his fastball, to me, probably not a big thing in the grand scheme of things.
Yeah, it's funny because Duffy used to be a pretty hard throwing guy. I mean, he got up to like 98, 99. Yeah. Earlier in his career, and then the last 2 years, he went through, I think, 2 surgeries, maybe even had 3 surgeries. I mean, he had definitely 2 surgeries. He had a Tommy John for one of them. And, yeah, he's turned into a guy that's, you know, his high end now. He might get to 96 once in a while. I think last year he touched 96 a little bit. But I think he's probably, you know, most of the time he's right around 93, 94. And, yeah, now that first start, I think he was down to about 91, 92. You know, you're right. I mean, he could be adapting and turning into a different type of pitcher, and maybe it doesn't, you know, affect him as much, but you definitely don't want to be playing on a guy like that. I feel like until you see a couple more starts and see where it's going as far as a trend. But nonetheless, I think we'll see some runs here in Detroit.
Yeah, especially too. I'm going back, and he's not a guy that's had pinpoint control throughout his career. He's made a career because he's left-handed and throws hard. Well, now all of a sudden he's left-handed and he doesn't throw hard, so. To me, he kind of qualifies as a guy to, you know, monitor. And, again, you're either not betting, period, or you're betting against them, or you're betting the over like we should here for today. So, hey, great stuff here with Eric Waz. Breaking out some Major League Baseball. We're going to aim to have either tomorrow or Friday, we're going to get Aaron Renning in here, and we're going to talk about the kickoff of the NBA season and the playoffs. And then next week, we'll start to really pick it up in terms of podcast frequency. We'll give you an update on the schedule, but we're going to aim here for at least 3 podcasts next week. We're also going to be having more and more content here on betteriq.com. Plenty of guys contributing excellent articles to help you become a better sports better. So look forward to that. In the meantime, enjoy the rest of your afternoon, and we'll be back at it again either Thursday or Friday.